2023. Right in there. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. So, quick question. This sounds okay. That sounds right. All right. So, question, show of hands. How many in the room you would love to get more done faster with fewer headaches and hassle and less drama and trauma? Raise your hand, please. Woo-hoo! And if you didn't raise your hand on that one, you can keep it the hard way. Or how about this one? How many of you would love it if your employee team would take ownership for finding solutions on how to make things run more efficiently and take better care of customers? How many people would be excited about that? Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo! All right. Then if you raised your hand, you are absolutely in the right spot today. So I'm Mark Rosenberger. I'm the performance specialist with Insperity here in San Diego. And for the last 25 years, I've had an opportunity to work with organizations, kind of identifying the gap between where they're at and where they want to be. And more times than not, when we focus on things, we focus on three things. How many? Okay, that was a little weak. Let's try that again. Okay. We focus on three things. How many?
Three.
Thank you very much. All right. Number one is, raise your finger, people. How many does this apply to? Okay, number two is processes. Anybody got processes in their universe? And then the third focus is company culture. Raise your finger if that's important, right? So company culture. So today's program hits on all three of those items. And just quick question, how many here, you're giddy today? Okay. All right, good, that was good. How about mildly perky?
We got a few of those? Okay, we got a few mildly perky, all right, okay. Okay, good.
Well, I want to step back just a second and share with you why I am so giddy about this day and your being here. So I'm going to tell a story. Is that okay? So I have an opportunity to play with a bunch of our clients and kind of go in and do a variety of different things. And earlier this year, about February, I went to visit our first associates folks. Raise your hand. Okay. So it's their fault you're here today. All right. And I walked in. And I hadn't been there a while, and there was something different. There was kind of like a bounce in their step. It was like people were smiling at each other. And it was like, what's going on? And then somebody shared with me, oh, we got 2 second leaned. And I went, huh? 2 second what? Oh no, yeah, and they pulled out the book, this Paul Akers guy. We're reading it and people were kind of looking for waste and how to fix things and they're taking videos of their improvements and people are kind of owning the process and stuff. And I went, huh? So people, processes, what's the third one?
Culture
was starting to be impacted. And I said, whoa, because I'm on the hunt for stuff that works with clients. So I went back and literally devoured videos, read the book, looked into this and said, we need to have Paul Akers here to share with us today. So when it comes to people, processes, and what's the third one? Thank you. You're gonna get, today I am giddy. Okay, so I offer you to join me that, in me in that. So a couple of things, housekeeping things as we get going. It would be inappropriate if I didn't make one or two introductions. So how many know Doug Walker from our San Diego office? Stand up. So Doug's my boss, and he gave me 20 bucks to introduce him. So we're over there, right? Down from our Diamond Bar office, Cynthia James. Where's Cynthia? Here. Right there, Cynthia. Cynthia is Doug's boss, and she's the director of field services. So she kind of oversees taking great care of you, all of our client folks there. And honored to have you here. And then Cheryl Schmidt is our, all the way from Diamond Bar. Okay. She's our general manager of the Western Region Field Service Operations. Did I get that on one card? All right. So she's Cynthia's boss, and the two of them have been pushing, and challenging us to look at things differently, challenge the status quo, look for ways to take brilliant care of our customers in new ways. So if today works for you, let them know. If it doesn't work for you, I guess let them know too. Yeah, there you go. I'll know for that. All right, so I think we're ready to rock. Are you ready to rock?
Yes.
Okay, take your right hand like this. All right, play with me here. Come on, play with me here. Okay, look at your neighbor. Okay, give him a high five and say, let's rock. All right, we'll work on sincerity next time. All right. Or not, yeah. All right, so I'm going to invite Doug to come up and introduce our presenter today. Both of us wanted the pleasure of introducing Paul because we've grown an affinity for him and what the impact he's having. But we did rock, paper, scissors, and I won. And then he told me he was my boss. So I guess he won, all right?
So, cost me another $20.
Yeah. So it's my honor to introduce Doug. Doug and I have known each other for roughly 20 years, working as co-hearts out in the business world. And so it's my honor every day to come to work and get expanded and to challenge ideas and bounce things around with Doug and have a fun time taking great care of you. So to do our introduction, Mr. Walker. Let's hear it for Mr. Walker. Yeah.
When we read that and we had a connection with Bob and we knew we wanted to get Paul to come, Paul's in Bellingham, Washington, a couple hours north of Seattle, so we're thinking, how are we going to get this guy to come down here? So I emailed to Bob Taylor, got an email back from him the next morning, said, I called Paul for you, and he's willing to hear what you got in mind, and he introduced the two of us via email, and I got 5 minutes later an email from Paul Akers saying, Doug, what do you need? And I wrote back, you're in the 2 second lane, I'll cut right to the chase. I want you to come down and be our speaker in October. I was a little bolder than I normally am, but I figured the door was open. He wrote back and he said, Doug, I'd literally get 2 to 3 requests a day to travel somewhere in the world. I'm just back from Kazakhstan. I normally charge, what is it, $500,000 a talk or something like that? And I like to limit my talks to companies that are really serious about lean. However, when Bob Taylor asked me to do something, I simply say yes. He didn't charge us transportation, food, lodging, none of that. And he provided all of these books to you at his expense. So when I told Bob that this was going to work out, and I said, you know, if you want to come, fine. So he emailed me and he said, can I come and bring 7 or 8 of my people? So these are all people from Taylor Guitar. He's the reason Paul's here, so of course I said yes. And then he said what I think is the best introduction for Paul possibly. The teacher wants to sit at the foot of the student and learn from the student. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's certainly my pleasure to ask you to help me welcome the student, Paul Akers.
I want to show you what lean is all about, 2 second lean. Oh, I love technical problems right out the gate. People always ask me, what is 2 second lean? So I took out my iPhone and I made a recording for 60 seconds on my definition of two-second lean. Then I went on the internet and found this company called Fiverr, F-I-V-E-R-R. Anyone know who they are? Anyone heard of it? A couple of the young people here. Amazing organization. And they basically do technical work for you for $5. So for $5, they produced this video for me. So in the course of 24 hours, this video got produced, and I am just wondering what is going on here. Let's see here. We'll be technically challenged. So this is the definition of two-second lean in 60 seconds. And basically, if you get this, we don't even need to talk anymore. So here we go. Let's look at it.
Welcome to my world of two-second lean. What is two-second lean? It is simple. I took a world-class business concept practiced by the top companies in the world, Toyota, Harley-Davidson, Porsche, and made it fun and easy so anyone could tap into the power of daily continuous improvement. There are three easy steps to become a powerful lean thinker. First, learn the eight wastes. Overproduction, transportation, inventory, defects, overprocessing, motion, waiting, wasted human potential. Then you will see these different wastes everywhere, and it will drive you crazy. Second, you will be compelled to eliminate the waste you now see and make improvements every day that removes the waste in your life. Make it the first thing you do every day. Small, consistent, tiny, two-second improvements, all hooked together day after day, adds up to mountains of more free time, friend time, and play time. You see, there's nothing cool about being wasteful, and there is everything cool about becoming a lean thinker. Third, pull out your smartphone and shoot a quick video to show your improvements to your friends, family, and coworkers. That's it. Prepare to experience the power of becoming a lean thinker.
Not bad for $5, eh? 60 seconds, iPhone, that's it. It's that simple. See waste, make improvements, make it fun, use your smartphone, make a video. That's it. That's all I teach all over the world. And people go, wow, I can do that. This is not that difficult. And that is the key, because everyone can get it, from the janitor to the president of the company. Coca-Cola bought 600 books from us one time. And I called them up and I said, why did you buy 600 of these books? And they said, it's really simple. Because the janitor gets it and the president gets it. You made it so simple. And you know, I wasn't a great student in school. I was a C and D student. I struggled, dyslexia, had a few problems. So I had a propensity to want to make things simple. And that's what you're going to see today. You're going to see a very sophisticated, very thoughtful business concept called lean manufacturing, made so simple that everybody loves to do it. So I have a true confession. I don't like lean. I don't like lean. I love lean. I'm a maniac about it. Why? Because it improves the quality of my life dramatically, consistently every day, and everybody I teach this to and gets it, it improves the quality of their life dramatically and consistently every day. I love lean. This is not something I do on the side. I live and breathe it 24/7. Okay, so my goal. Everything I do in life is simple. My goal is this, for you to see waste. I want you to see waste like you've never seen it before. When you walk out of this room in an hour and a half, I want you to say, oh my gosh, I had no idea there was so much waste everywhere. Now, waste is not a good thing, but eliminating waste is an incredible thing. And that's what you're going to learn and see what we do. When you see waste, it should electrify you. You should just like, oh my gosh, there it is. How can we get rid of it? How can we engage our brains and use our creativity to improve the situation? That's all we're doing every day. So this is the FastCap team that makes all these amazing improvements. You're going to see a lot of their improvements today. And basically all we ask them to do is every morning they walk in, we clean our entire facility. We sort through everything. We get rid of all the things that don't belong in our area. And then we create clear standards, we make a two-second improvement, and we meet as a team. And that takes about an hour and a half every day, and then we work. It's the end then that is the most important part. Lean is not incidental to us. It is everything to us. We don't talk about lean, we do lean first, and then we work. And that's the defining part, because most people can't get their head around that. I don't have time to work. I don't have time to do lean. I've got to work. We have so many orders. It's just the opposite. Lean keeps giving you more and more time. The more pressure that comes on you, the less pressure that happens when you're consistently implementing lean. So I like to give people a little overview of my company so they have a clue what we're all about. I did this video, again, on my iPhone. I did it in about, took me no more than an hour to put this together. I didn't have a film crew following me around. I did it all on my iPhone. I did it 3 months after we moved into our facility. We've been in there about 2 years now. It doesn't even look anything like what you're going to see right now. But this is what it looked like after three months being in there. It looked this good. Most people look at it and say, God, it looks like a dream facility. It's like a fairy tale. Well, this is just in 3 months. Imagine what it looks like with 50 people making 2 and 3 improvements every day, nonstop. It just keeps getting better and better and better. Work keeps getting easier, more enjoyable. Our customers are happy. We keep adding more value. We have to advertise.
Well, hello everyone. It's time to take a tour of FastCap. FastCap is located in Bellingham, Washington, just about 2 hours north of Seattle, up in a little tiny town called Ferndale, right on I-5. It's a beautiful place. We have about a 50,000 square foot facility. It's just really, really cool place to work. About 110 windows, lots of natural light everywhere coming in. We're going to take you inside. Now remember, it's simple. It's not fancy. So when you get inside, just a big overview, we got 3 big ass fans keeping everything cool and lots of natural light everywhere. When you walk in the front door, it's all stand up. We made all the desks out of our fast pipe system. Everything simple. Now people always say, well, do people like to stand up? We wouldn't have it any other way. Is it difficult to stand up? Sure, it takes a little time to get used to it, but we love it. Everything's on wheels. Everything's flexible, including the filing cabinet. Conference room, very simple, stand up, no chairs. Meetings don't last very long. Our graphic design area, again, everything's stand up. Everything's on wheels. Everything's flexible. We want to be flexible because our needs are always changing. All our tools are carefully shadowed. We never search for anything. We never struggle, because the minute you struggle, you have waste. Our main production line, everything flowing towards the shipping terminals. You'll see how that works here in just a minute. It's very cool. See, that's an aisle where the product is made, flows down to the area where we package it. People are in the cells. They pick, package, and ship. Everything 2 hours, fax to truck. It's pretty amazing. So this is our shadow board of all the products that we make. So we do lateral thinking. We walk up, we look at it and say, hey, we've made a part like that before. This is our CNC area where we make all of our molds. All of our toolboxes are carefully shadowed out with our Kaizen foam system. It makes all the difference in the world when you take the time to make this happen. Now, the way this looks like this is every day we make an improvement. These are our injection molding machines. They're Sumitomo's. They're really high tech. They're very cool. They have robots on them to remove the parts. All the tools, again, are shattered out for the Sumitomo's. These are all of our injection molds down below with the parts actually magnetically attached to them. These are all the colorants and materials that we use with Kanban cards.
And the way we accomplish all this is so simple. We sweep, sort, and standardize everything in the morning when we come in. Everyone makes one improvement. We have a morning meeting. We build a culture, and then we work. And I am fully engaged in the process. The leader has to be engaged. You gotta keep lean simple and make it fun. The rest is history.
Nice. Never forget, lean is simple and fun. So it's that simple. See waste and think lean. It takes care of everything. So what was my goal again? Anyone remember? To see waste. That's all you have to do. If you can see waste like you've never seen it before at the end of this presentation, it's over with. Now, I like to illustrate that everything in life is a process. And all lean is trying to do is take from the time you start the process to the time you finish the process and see the waste that's in between and eliminate it and deliver more value to the customer. So instead of taking an hour to do something, now it takes 30 minutes. And now it takes 30 minutes, now it takes 15 minutes. And pretty soon, we've taken and removed all the waste from the starting point to the ending point. Everything you do in life is a process. How you brush your teeth is a process. How you make your lunch is a process. How you answer your emails is a process. How you make innovative woodworking tools is a process. How we set up for this event is a process. Everything is a process. Everything has waste. All your job is to learn to see the waste, the non-value-added activity, and consistently remove it and never stop removing it. Remember, never stop removing it because it's always there. Lean is a journey. You don't become lean. You are on a lifetime journey of learning to see waste and eliminating it and improving the value that you deliver to your customer. And you have two customers. You have internal customers and you have external customers. Every one of you sitting here is working with team members. They are your customers. You are a servant to them. Then you have external customers. You are a servant to them. If you take on this mindset, everything changes. You take yourself off the throne and you put the people you're working with as the most important people in your life. And you do that by eliminating waste and improving processes so they get what they want at the most efficient way on a consistently improving methodology. I like to use the process of changing a tire to illustrate this. So if I asked you to change a tire in your car, how long would it take you guys to do it? Anybody have any ideas? How long it takes AAA to get there, right? So, you know, I hear all kinds of stories, 15 minutes, a half hour, 45 minutes. 45 minutes is my favorite one because it takes a half hour to get all the crap out of the back of the trunk to find the spare tire to do it, right? So I'm going to show you a bad tire change, and I'm going to show you a world-class tire change. So you can see the contrast between two different processes because everything is a process. Here's a bad tire change. Now, this is the customer. Is he happy? What's he want to be doing? He wants to be racing, okay? There's no value added right now. The value is in him going around the track and winning the race. Now, look at these guys. Yeah. We got, this is called a defect in the lean world, okay? That's a problem, okay? So the customer didn't get what they wanted. And you know, I know it's very funny, but I'm going to tell you, this is happening all day long in your organization and in my organization. We do these silly, stupid things to our customers nonstop. We drive them crazy, but we don't see it. And the goal of the talk is for you to see it. Now, this is world class, and I got to be honest with you. I want to say this humbly. This is the world I live in. This is what FastCap is like for the most part. Now, we still have all kinds of problems, but this is the world that I live in, and you'll see it here.
In the pit lane, out of everybody, this is Fernando Alonso's stop. It was actually the fastest single stop. And look at the guys. They look so relaxed, but there he goes. All four wheels changed and out in 3.3 seconds.
3 seconds. Now I want you to notice how relaxed everyone is. We're going to run it one more time. Look at the people working here. Do they look stressed out?
They look so relaxed, but there he goes.
No problem. Just 3 seconds. Four wheels. Pretty cool, isn't it? It's pretty cool. This is what happens with lean. Operational excellence. Who doesn't want to be a part of this? It is contagious, man, when you get this going on in your corporation. I'm telling you, it's nuts what happens. As Mark said, you guys are awesome. You had a smile in your step. You know, all of a sudden work used to be kind of difficult, and all of a sudden it becomes really cool. This is what happens because improvement is magnetic. So this is the world I live in. We had a company go through on a tour in our facility, and they were watching one of our processes because we show them how we do things. And one of the individuals said, you know, I think Austin's process here of opening the case has a lot of waste in it. And look, we have Toyota's come to see us. Toyota taught us this stuff, and Toyota has come to learn from us. Boeing, Bombardier, you can't name them, Amazon. Every major corporation has come to learn from us. Now, you would think at that level that when someone says something to us, we would say, oh, well, we got it all figured out. Don't tell us. Just the opposite. Really, there's waste? Oh, we know there's waste everywhere. And somebody said, there's waste in the way he opens the case. And so we said, wow, how can we fix that? This is what happened.
So Austin, show me your great new improvement.
In this gym, to start the case, we have to open it up and always have to fumble around with this. Really difficult.
Poor latches, a little cumbersome.
Opens it up, really difficult. So check this out. Wes from the YPO gave me this great idea about how to open the hinges. Very simple, close the case, really simple. Look at that, all closed, all nice and easy to go.
One motion.
One motion.
Amazing job.
Thanks, Wes.
Now, most people would never look at opening that case and say there's any waste. That's just what you do. But when you become a lean thinker, everything changes. You see value and you see non-value. And fumbling with the latch is non-value. It's waste. And how can we engage our brain, have some fun, little innovation, and figure out how to make it easy? When work is easy, you get more done, not just because it's faster, because you're emotionally attached to it. It feels good. This is what happens in our facility all day long. People have the freedom to do anything they want. We love it. We love it that they fail. They have learned to fail. Because if you don't learn to fail, you will fail to learn. So Matt Stotola, great guy, runs a big construction company called Excel. He came up with a great product, and he walked into my office the other day, and he said, Paul, you know, the product that we developed that's doing really well with our company, you know, they have probably 1,000 employees, and we're selling tons of it. But I said, Matt, but why aren't the other construction companies buying it? You know, and he goes, well, you know, he looked at me just in straight face. Some people would rather use a rock than a hammer. I said, wow, that's incredible. So we made a video to illustrate that.
Hey, Matt, what are you doing?
Just working.
I mean, have you ever thought about maybe like using a hammer? I mean...
A what?
A hammer.
What is it?
It'll make your job and your life a lot easier. That rock looks a little maybe like archaic.
Hey, it's been working for me up to this point. I'm gonna keep using this. I don't have time.
So in order to be a lean thinker, you can't be satisfied with using the rock you've been using for the past 50 years. You got to think differently about things. You got to say, hey, there is a better way. But so many people are stuck using the rock. They don't think it could possibly be, there could be possibly be a better way. So my favorite illustration of this is Delta Airlines. So the other day I was flying on Delta Airlines, it's actually a couple years ago. And I got this ticket, and I'm dyslexic, and I struggle a little bit with small print. Don't have the best little eyesight in the world for the little print, if you will. And I looked at that, and I said, wow, that is the most convoluted airplane ticket I've ever seen. I mean, nothing lines up. Things are overlapped. We have different fonts. I mean, there's nothing laid out in the order it's supposed to be. I'm going, this is, like, insane. And as a lean thinker, I look at it and say, value, non-value. I said, that's a disaster. I'm going to miss my flight. I don't even know what gate I'm supposed to go to, right? Now, Delta's a billion-dollar organization, but this is the seamlessness that things happen at my company. I pulled out my iPhone, put the ticket on my leg, and shot a picture of it. I sent it to my graphic design department, where a 25-year-old and a 23-year-old work. Not Delta Airlines, not a billion-dollar organization. And I said, would you design for me a lean airline ticket? In 15 minutes, this is what I got back. Hold on, don't anyone fall on the floor, okay? This is lean. This is why lean's so cool. This is why I love lean. It's so simple, everyone gets it. Everything's laid out in the sequence that it should be. I'm going from Seattle to New York. The next thing I need to know is what gate I'm at. It's visual. What time do I board? Visual. Where am I sitting? I don't have to worry if I'm on the aisle, the window, in the front of the plane, the back of the plane. I know exactly where. Think how much time that would save just boarding the plane if they put that on there. Right? And what time does the plane leave? The plane's departing. I need to know this information. Could you imagine if they standardized this in all airlines, what would happen? They probably have to make the airport smaller because everything would happen so much more efficiently. Right? But it's not good enough. It can be improved. It's so much better. This is what lean delivers all the time. Everything's a process. So if you think I'm not a manufacturer, this is paper world, man. It can always be improved. So we had Toyota come to our facility. I showed them this slide. And immediately they said, Toyota, come on. They get it, right? I see an improvement. Did I get defensive and say, hey, I invented this thing? Just the opposite. I said, where? They said, you need to put an arrow here to make sure it's clear the direction you're flying. Great idea. You need to put the time you arrive, because you can tell the people what time to be there, so there's no ambiguity there. It's total clarity. And we changed the date to the top. So there you go, just like that. Another small 2-second improvement. That's all we're asking people to do, is make the tiniest little improvement. We don't want monstrosities. We don't want you to save $1 million in the first improvement. We don't want to save $100. We want you to save 2 seconds. Because the 2 seconds add up to 2 minutes, the 2 minutes add up to 2 hours, the 2 hours add up to 2 years. That's it. We want you to start conditioning your brain to see waste and make small improvements and make experiments and fail and learn what doesn't work and then readjust. So we evaluate every improvement in our company, because I know everyone's asking right now, how do you trust your people to do this? Well, first of all, we train our people relentlessly, so it's easy to trust them because we train them properly. But the criteria for improvement is safety, quality, simplicity, and speed. That's what we're looking for. And in that order, in that priority. So we don't make an improvement if it's not safer. Even though it saves time and it's more efficient, it might even improve the quality. But if it's not safer, we're not going to do it. Then the next criteria is quality. It is not speed. Everyone thinks that lean is all about making everything faster and faster and faster. It's really all about quality. Think about the airline ticket. Is it a better quality? Let's go through it real quick. Is the airline ticket safer? Is there a safety issue? Probably no safety issue, other than I'm not going to have a heart attack because I'm not going to miss many planes, right? Quality-wise, the quality is way better for the customer, right? Simplicity, is it simpler? Way simpler, right? And speed, is it way faster to get the information I want? Way faster. So it met the criteria. It didn't necessarily meet the first one, but the next three it met perfectly. But it didn't impair safety. If anything, it improved it, right? That's it. So you don't have to worry about whether or not it's Martha Sue's idea or Bob's idea or Teresa's idea. It's totally irrelevant. We're looking at this as the filter to determine whether or not an improvement is relevant. And when you teach your people to do that, all of a sudden the egos go away, because we're looking at this. We're saying, hey, did we improve the quality? Not, it's my idea. I like it better that way. It has nothing to do with what you like. This is the criteria we're looking at. So let's just do a humorous little one and see whether or not it meets the criteria. Unloading a truck. Questionable. I'm not really sure, but I think it could not be. Quality. Maybe it damaged the material. I'm not really sure. Right? Simpler? Way simpler. Right? Way simpler. And faster? No question. Right? So it wins the last two without a doubt. But we got to measure. We're not right there. I can't see everything that's going on, but we have to ask ourselves about the safety and quality. It's that simple. So it's not complicated. You don't have to have a degree from Harvard to figure this stuff out. So the ground rules for this talk and for lean and for 2-second lean concept are this. Lean is simple and it's fun. It's not a crazy business concept that you have to have a black belt in to do. No! Stop that nonsense. Anyone can figure this out. We teach this to school kids and they eat it up. 7-year-olds do it way better than 50-year-olds because they get it. They're not inhibited by all the garbage that we put on top of people and the bureaucracy that goes on. So the best way to illustrate that is Harvard. You know, we love Harvard, great institution, produced a lot of great learning, a lot of great students, and a lot of great people out of there. But, you know, they wanted to figure out why students learn. So the government funded a program, spent $5 million in a grant, and gave it to them, and they spent 5 years trying to figure out why students learn. This is what we do. We are crazy about making things complicated. I have no idea why people have a predilection to do this, but man, do they have a predilection to make things complicated. So Harvard spent 5 years and $5 million, and this is what they found out. Show up to class on time. Show up, right? You show up and sit in the front row. So my A students right here, my B students, my C, my D, my F in the back. That's it. It's that simple. Lean is simple and it is fun. Don't overcomplicate this. But we love bureaucracy. We love that red tape, baby. Get it out. Spin it around. Empower ourselves. You have to go through me. I'm the rule maker. It's not what it's about. Well, we like to do something called using our wits and not our wallet as lean thinkers. But we love to spend money, don't we? Oh, we'll just go buy something. So men have a problem. They tend to be a little messy in the bathroom. And so over the years, all these smart engineers have come up with all these different great toilet scenarios where you could maybe not have as much cleanup. And they had a contest, and this one particularly, they said 95% said this new design was going to be very useful and solve the problem that men have in the bathroom. Okay? But of course, there's always some smart lean thinker somewhere, and this guy happened to be a statistician, I believe, in Amsterdam. And he said, hey, all we have to do is etch a black fly in a small toilet, right? And give a man a target, and we're set. You know? It's not that hard. But we love to make things complicated. We love it. So where are all these improvements? They're right under your nose. They're everywhere. They are everywhere. You have thousands of improvements right in front of you, which you do every day. All you have to do is learn the eight ways, and you will begin to see it everywhere. And you'll put a big smile on your face because now you'll have the power to begin to systematically start making those improvements and improve the quality of your life, add more joy to your life, add more joy to the people you serve. Everything gets better. That's why I love Lean. So, as we teach this concept, it's so simple and so much fun to organizations around the world. I mean, it's hard to go in a country anywhere that's not doing 2 second Lean because they don't need me. That's the beauty. They don't need me. I don't have to go visit them and encourage them and do anything. Just read the book and go, God, this is so simple. Anyone could do it. So this one I love. This is Mission Bell, a huge cabinet organization up in San Francisco Bay Area. They do Google. They do Apple. They do all that stuff. And they totally latched onto this. And this is one of their improvements that I love.
Here at Mission Bell, we've made a lean improvement to our application process. It used to be somebody would come into the front desk and they'd ask for an application. We'd give them this 6-page paper copy. They'd fill it out, return it to the front desk, who would walk it up to Jessica, our recruiter, who would then walk over to the scanner, scan the file in so it could save to her computer, and then she'd file this paper file. Now if somebody comes to the front desk, we give them this card. It says, want to work for us? Please complete our online application at missionbell.com/application.html. So they can go home or use the public library to fill out the application and send it to us. When we receive the application online, Jessica doesn't have to scan it. Nobody has to walk around. It's all ready to go. This reduces over-processing of Jessica having to take the paper form to the scanner and scan it back to her computer. It reduces defects from possible misspellings or writing that we can't understand on the application because now it's just typed in and we can understand the typed words. Motion of the receptionist having to walk the application to Jessica and Jessica having to walk to the scanner and back, and inventory of the paper copies that used to go in a drawer. We fixed all that with just a little card.
Did you notice that she saw waste? You notice how she went through the waste that she eliminated with a smile on her face? I mean, before work was difficult. You had to do all these paperwork. Now it's just like, This is fun. So simple. It's so simple. This is at my company, and this is Lucas. He's one of our production engineers, and he's constantly coming up with great ideas, and this is one that's so fun. And you'll kind of see our people are crazy. They're not just like doing lean. All the boss says do lean. I mean, they're crazy about this.
I want to show you an amazing 2-second improvement. This is the product we make, the magnetic 11-finger. It's a push stick which sticks right on your table saw. And Lucas came up with an incredible way to make that more efficient in the way we install the magnets here.
All right, so we're at 11 fingers here. This is an 11 finger. It's a new product from FastCap, and it needs two magnets pressed into it here after it comes out of the injection molding machine. So when we first started building these, we had to come up with a way to do it. So I'll show you the method and how long it takes here. Start that, you take your magnet, you push it in with your finger there. You push another magnet in with your finger there. You'd have to push these down on the tabletop, and then you'd have to hold it up and make sure you could not see the magnet sticking out and press it again if it didn't work. So building one that way took 14 seconds approximately, and it caused your fingers a ton of pain. We had some problems with that still in shipping. People had issues with the magnets coming out when they got knocked against things, even though they're actually attracted to each other and they go back in quite easily. We were having issues. So we came up with a way to make it less painful on your fingers and faster. And so we'll show you that next here. An improvement, we made a couple jigs here to make this process less painful, faster, and higher quality. First one is a 3D printed little piece that goes on your thumb here. Works a lot like a Pez dispenser. So with this and this jig we built, you would put your thumb dispenser on and wear it the whole time. And you would use it, slide it up the stack, and you would use it to push it into the 11th finger, just like that. And that saved your fingers pain. When you're done with that though, they're sticking out quite a ways. So we'd put it in this jig, and we'd press the magnets in with the jig. You wouldn't have to check it because the press gets them in there tighter, and that eliminated a lot of problems with the magnets coming out. They don't come out very easily with that. However, the thing on your thumb made it hard to put a sticker on this once you were wearing it and slowed you down packaging the finger. But that also took 15 seconds, so really wasn't any faster.
But so in the spirit of constant improvement, we thought we could make this even better. And so here's what we came up with that we think is the ultimate solution.
This is the awesome jig we came up with. It works on a hopper system. So to load it up, you just drop your stacks of magnets in your hopper here. And now to build them, all you gotta do is press the magnets in. So we'll time it this way and start. And stop. And that was 3 seconds. So to do these fast, I can just that, we've improved the quality. The magnets get pressed in better. I challenge you to get these magnets out of here once we've pressed them in, and we can build 5 in the 15 seconds it took to build one before.
Yeah! 5 times faster. Not a 10% improvement, 5 times faster, right? This is what happens everywhere. I mean, there's so much waste, it's staggering. Now remember, we're a lean company. Like, we're like really into this. We teach people. And look at the waste that we have going on. It's crazy. And we just keep uncovering. We've been doing this for like 15 years. You finally think we'd run out of ideas. We're still making 100 improvements a day, hands down. Never stops. It never stops. Look at the criteria for that. Safety, safer, not hurting your hand. Right? Quality, better quality. Absolute, pressed in every time. The magnets are not coming out. Is it simpler? Way simpler. Is it faster? It met all 4 criteria. It didn't have to meet all 4, but it met all 4, and that's a great thing. So we love to have fun. Now, you kind of are starting to see, I've shown you a lot of videos, why videos are so important. We're able to take this one video and create a video learning laboratory, a library for our company and for the world, because people all over the world are watching. Our videos have like 50, 60,000 views. We have people around the world learning. That's why the power of a video is so awesome. That's why we say that's the third component. And you don't have to have a video production crew to do it. You've got it all on your iPhone or on your Android. You can do it all. It's so simple. Just show the current state. You show the current state and the improvement. Make it short, make it sweet, and you're done. Wow. Blows me away every time I think about it. Okay? So here is making lean really fun. And this maybe is not the most relevant improvement, but it illustrates how much joy we get from what we do.
Hey, Paul here. So, you know, people come on a tour here, and one of the things we love to show them is our kitchen table, how we leave everything perfectly clean all the time, and we have our salt and pepper marked out, we have our Windex marked out, we have our paper towels marked out, and people have been watching the videos we've been posting about the tours, and this one guy looks at it and says, Paul, you know, that's really cool, but why don't you use magnets? Then you don't have to worry about kind of realigning the salt and pepper and getting it right over the thing. And I go, no, that's a great idea. And we're like the magnet kings. We make all kinds of different magnets. So Andre and I undertook this project to put magnets under the Windex, the paper towels, and the salt and pepper shaker. So this is what it looks like. Check this out. You take the salt, boom, it just goes right onto there. But the best thing is, you go over and you try to put the salt on the pepper, and it doesn't go on there because of reverse the polarity. You put them on there, look at that. They both just go on perfectly. The same thing with this. Is that incredible? I know. Look at this. Check this one out. Look at that. It just goes into place.
This.
One of our people that came on a tour, or somebody watched a tour. Is that amazing?
That just makes lunch so much more enjoyable.
I know. It's fun, isn't it? It looks like you're gonna cry. It's crazy, isn't it? We take our improvements very seriously here at FastCap. It's a big deal to us. So if you want to give us an idea on how we can improve, we would love to know about it. Right, Elena?
Wow.
Oh, you'll get over it. It's okay. It's
just an improvement. Just an improvement. We have so much fun what we do. It's just awesome. It's nonstop. We let people do crazy stuff like that. We don't care. It's all about learning. We create a learning organization where people are engaged in their brains. We don't want drones. We want people that are thinking. But unfortunately, this is what we're doing to our customers and our team members. We make life so difficult. Every day is an obstacle course. This is what work is like for a lot of people. You know, I just got back from Kazakhstan. I would love to show you some of the videos. It'd be a whole different presentation. But I'm dealing with a company there. It's $1.8 billion. They build 2 million square feet a year. It's staggering. Imagine seeing a city with hundreds of cranes everywhere, and it's all this one organization. It's all started by a guy named Aiden. He's about 43 years old. He started right out of college with two of his buddies. It's 8,000 employees, the most amazing company, just crazy. They asked me to come in because they wanted to see if I could help them maybe a little. And they said, you know, we thought you'd find a little bit of waste. And it was so dysfunctional, it was staggering. I said to Aiden, I said, you're building every building twice. As long as you're okay with doing $1.8 billion a year, when you could do it for half that amount, you just keep doing what you're doing. But you are building every building twice. This is what his people were going through. Everywhere I went, I said, oh my gosh. And I started showing it to him, and he goes, I couldn't see it. They couldn't see it. But as soon as I started to show him the waste and what was going on, I'm going to show a video later on, you're going to see what I'm talking about. It was everywhere. And he said, Paul, I understand we're probably building every building four times. There's that much weight. And before we pick on Aiden, they're world class. I'm going to challenge you. I guarantee every one of you are expending twice as much to do everything you're doing. There is no question, because I know I'm doing that right now. There's that level of improvement. And all you need to do is learn to see waste. Learn the eight ways. Start making small improvements. Have fun. Pull out your video. Say, hey, this is the stupid stuff that we're doing now. And this is our little improvement. That's it. It's no more than that. So these kids came in, Brad and John, very young, much younger than me. And, you know, I thought they were going to basically come in and tweak my great company or my really good company. And what they did was they tore it apart and put it back together. And they changed everything into U-shaped cells. They got rid of all the inventory that we had. Not all of it, but a lot of it. And they said, why are you making so much inventory? I said, well, because the machines take 45 minutes to set up. And they said, well, why do they take 45 minutes to set up? I go, well, I don't know. It just takes a long time. It's very difficult to get the parts to come out right. So once we get it set up, we just run a whole bunch of them and put it on the shelf. He goes, well, let's work on that. In 1 week, they took the process from 45 minutes. Remember, Lean, we're not looking for 10% improvements, although you'll make some 10% incremental improvements. From 45 minutes to 5 minutes to set the machine up. All of a sudden, all the inventory went around. We started making everything just in time. $30,000 in net profit to the bottom line in 3 months. A month. A little bit of waste, you think? Crazy. The waste was just swimming around us. Then they went in and did the same thing to laser jam. 45 minutes to make a single laser jam to 7 minutes in 1 week. Crazy. We were making 100 laser jams at a time because I thought that was the way to do it in batch work. But they said, no, I'm going to teach you how to make one at a time all the way through. So when you get to the end of the process and it's done, if there's a defect, you're not reworking 100 laser jams. You're not managing and pushing 100 laser jams around carts all over your facility. You just have one. The customer wants one. How long does it take to make a laser jam? 7 minutes. We get a phone call, 7 minutes. It's done. We don't have to have a big, huge rack of inventory of them. We only need maybe one on the shelf to pull from the grocery store, and then it gets replenished. This was just totally different thinking to the way I thought about everything. It's counterintuitive. We like to make and produce a whole bunch of stuff. It's just what we do. Lean will put everything on its head. So I immediately got on a plane and went over to Japan and started seeing what Toyota was doing. And I saw stand-up desks. I saw people, open communication. I saw everything so different than anything I'd ever seen before. I went into factories that were like Disneyland. I mean, painted, great light coming in, everything visually controlled. It was just beautiful. This was a manufacturer of metal products. I mean, the dirtiest place you could ever imagine in a normal scenario. It was flawless. They had so much time they spent. Once a week, they spent cleaning the neighborhood. They walked around the whole neighborhood and they cleaned the neighborhood. Crazy. This is the Lexus plant in Kyushu, Japan. They paint the smokestacks yellow so the employees and the community can see whether or not they're polluting. Visual controls. We saw that with the airline tickets. This is Toto up here. They make toilets and plumbing fixtures. This is the dirtiest process you've ever been. If you've ever been to a toilet manufacturer or a faucet casting manufacturer, it is the dirtiest place you've ever seen. At Toto, it's perfect. Cleaner than any restaurant I've ever been in. They put all the soda machines on wheels. Everything's flexible. So if they have to repurpose a room, you just roll it another place. If you have to clean underneath the machine, they just roll everything. Everything was on wheels. I go, wow. They build flexibility into the process. This is the president of Toyota, or Toto. Zero PM, zero mistakes, zero defects, zero machine downtime, zero injuries. They're not looking for 5%. It's zero. Their standards were so much higher than anything I'd ever seen before. I was like, wow, this is crazy. Clueless, they were being nice to me when they said I was clueless. Visual controls on the metal, aluminum, blue, steel, fuchsia, just enough for a day's supply. They took down all the inventory and they said, well, it costs more money. Everyone says it costs more money to have the delivery truck come every day. Does it really cost more money? How much does a bigger building cost? How much does more inventory cost? More inventory, more insurance, more air conditioning, more lights? Does it really cost more money? So I went to a company that just blew me away, Hawks. About $100 million company, if I remember. I can't remember the exact numbers, but Jeremy, you've been there. You know what I'm talking about. And this company was losing millions of dollars, and they went from losing millions to making millions because they found out one simple thing, and it's called 3Sing. The magic of 3Sing, sweeping, sorting, and standardizing. So every morning, this is the president of the company. When I got there, he got me down on my hands and knees in my suit and made me polish their floor. I said, this is the stupidest thing I've ever done in my life. We have floor cleaners do that. Why are you making me do this? I'm trying to teach you humility, Paul. Get on the shop floor with your people. Finally, I got it. So the first thing they do, the president of the company, get down on his hands and knees and cleans the floor with his people and cleans the entire facility before they ever work. Then they sort through everything and they get rid of all the crap in the work area that has nothing to do with the work they're doing. And this is what happened when they started sorting their facility in that first year. They took all this stuff and they put it out in the back parking lot. All this stuff was cluttering up their work area. Open your drawers, look at your desk. You have so much clutter, it's unbelievable. What do we have, a $22 billion industry with storage with mini storage here in the United States. It's insane. We have so much crap, it's unbelievable. Right? It's crazy. Well, guess what? That same crap is in your organization where you work every day. But if you learn to get out of it, if you learn to sort it out in a disciplined way every day, this is what we do every day, is we're constantly sorting everything out. If it doesn't belong there, it's not part of what we do, we put it aside. We only have what we need there, and then we create clear standards on how we do everything. You saw it with the salt and pepper shaker, you saw it with everything. We're constantly making standards. Everywhere you go at FastCap, it's just like, it's so clear what you need to do. So now we freed up our brain to think about high-level stuff, not where's the salt and pepper? Oh, who put the salt and pepper? I mean, that's stupid work. We don't waste our time with stupid stuff like that. And that's all they did, and I learned this magic of 3S-ing. Now, one of the beautiful things that Bob set me up to succeed on so magically was that I was predisposed, and I've never told this story before, Bob, but I was predisposed to 3S-ing because every day when I got to work at Taylor Guitars when I was 17 years old, the first thing we did was we cleaned. So we made a lot of sawdust and chips the day before, but for whatever reason, Bob thought the best thing to do was to clean first thing in the morning, and I was never exposed to that before, but that's what we did. We went in and we swept everything, we cleaned everything. So when they showed me this, I said, God, this makes sense. This is what Bob taught me to do, you know? So I immediately latched onto it, and then we added the sorting and the standardization to it. It was magic. Now, people always say, Paul, why do you clean first thing in the morning? And I say, because Bob taught me to clean first thing in the morning. I mean, it was so obvious. What I really say is because in the morning, everybody's there. We work as a team, and we want to prepare to work. Okay? Why we don't do it in the evening? Because people are leaving at different times. People are exhausted. You don't really want to clean at the end of the day. So at FastCap, we clean in the morning. Bob set me up for that standard. I learned it again from Hawks. We perfected it, and it's been magical. So the first thing we do is we sweep, sort, and standardize, make an improvement, meet as a team, and that's our routine. It's so simple. But unfortunately, you know, this whole sweeping, sorting, standard is not relegated to manufacturing floors. We just go to your desktop, go to your computer. It's a disaster. I know because I see it all the time. You know, they pay me to come in and find this stuff. I go, well, what about that? You know, you open the desk drawer, it's a disaster, right? This is what my desk looks like. This is my laptop, my screen. This is my office. I'll stand up right on the shop floor. No walls. I don't have an office. There's no office. What do I need an office for? My job is to help my people do their job better, not to barricade myself behind a wall. This is my drawer. You open it up. Everything's standardized in our drawers. Everybody's got the same stuff in the front eye, in the front part of it. So if I go to any drawer, I know the scissors are going to be there. I know the sticky notes are going to be there. I know the pen's going to be there. We don't have pencil jars with tons of pencils. Why do we need 30 pencils on our? It's crazy. Sweep, sort, standardize. Think about it. It's so simple. Yeah, so they just set clear standards for everything. When I went to Hawks, I just couldn't believe how everything was so dialed in. So they had all this time to work at high-level things like producing better products for their customers and delivering more value. So this place blew me away, and I asked the president at the end of the tour, I said, this is so simple. And he said, Paul, smart people can't believe it can be this simple. We have advanced degrees, masters, PhDs, and we're paid to make things complex, it seems. But it's all so simple. So I said, I get it. All Toyota's doing is learning to see waste. They train their people to learn to see waste. And then they eliminate waste by fixing what bugs you. So you got all these things that are driving you crazy all day long, and for the most part, we just let them roll on by. But if you can learn to stop and say, wow, that was a little clunky having to plug in that cord right there. How could I make that a little bit better? And you start to develop this mindset of continuous improvement in small incremental ways, then all of a sudden everything in your life is going to get so much better. You're going to go, wow, this is crazy. So simple. Learn the eight ways. So I put it in fast food style just to make it fun. So the first thing we do is we overproduce hamburgers. All right, so we've got one customer there, but we make 10 hamburgers. So we overproduce. Then we transport the hamburgers up to the front warming tray. Of course, now we've got to have a warming tray. We've got to have a bigger warming tray. We have a bigger footprint, right? Because now we have to store all that stuff. We have to have the electricity for the lights, right? So you can see the waste cycle just starts blooming right in front of us when we overproduce. Okay? Next thing you know, the customer comes right here, and there's a customer who says, I don't want pickles. Oh, but we've made them all with pickles. So now we have a defect. See how simple this is? Lean is so simple. Understanding this stuff is so simple. So now we have a defect. What do we have to do? We have to overprocess. Now we have to take it apart. We have to scrape the pickle off. Okay, now we've wasted motion. The customer's waiting because we haven't got a clean process to deliver exactly what the customer wants when they want it, because we haven't taken the time to refine it. And then we've wasted the potential of the employees because we want them to do stupid work and drone work and just keep going on and on and doing the same thing without engaging their brain and seeing waste. That's the eight wastes. It's so simple. So as I developed this idea and began to learn it, I came back from Japan. I made this cheesy video that's got so many views, I don't even know how many views it has anymore, called The Lean Burrito. Pulled out my phone, and I made it because I saw waste everywhere. This is one of the first videos I ever made, one of the highest view videos. So here you go.
In an attempt to always find waste, this is my burrito that I'm eating. Now, they asked me when I bought it if I wanted sour cream and hot sauce, and I said yes. So instead of putting it in the burrito, they gave it to me in a separate container.
I have an idea.
Next time, put the sour cream and the hot sauce in the burrito. Okay, I just finished my burrito, and this is all the waste. We have the aluminum foil that's going to be thrown out, the paper that's going to be thrown out, the container from the salsa and the sour cream. We have two napkins, one I didn't use, and a whole little box here with a plastic fork and a plastic knife, all going to be put in the landfill for one burrito. All I really needed was the aluminum foil to wrap it in, and that was it. Sour cream, everything could have been inside, and one napkin. I would have made less of a mess, and I would have been perfect. Look at all the waste.
Check out this waste. We did a spreadsheet, 4 cents for the carton, the knife and fork, 6 cents. Everything added up to 31 cents of waste per burrito. 30 burritos a day, $9.30 times 7 days a week, 52 weeks, $3,385 per store. If you take 31 cents a burrito times 10 million burritos a day in the U.S. alone, that's $3.1 million in the landfill. That's total waste.
Okay, I'm back at the local coffee shop, Curb Shops, and we're going to get ourselves a lean burrito. Watch how this is done. Hi, Gina. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Can I get a lean burrito?
Sure.
I want a burrito with sour cream, hot sauce inside, aluminum foil, and nothing else in one napkin.
Sounds good.
Okay. Thanks, Gina. Here it comes, the lean burrito. What do we got? Aluminum foil, one napkin. Wow, that's amazing. Look at all the waste we eliminated. With the sour cream and everything inside. Isn't this yummy? Look at this thing. All ready to go, just the way I wanted it, just what the customer wanted, and no more and no less. Staggering, isn't it? It's everywhere. It's staggering how much we waste. And the joy that happens when you stop wasting and you start delivering more value and you have more valuable resources to deliver to your customer. And instead of prices going up, prices go down, quality goes up. It's crazy. When I was in Washington, D.C. a couple years back, I was introduced to speak to a group. This guy happens to be one of the top lean consultants in the country. Very smart guy, very capable. Knows lean very well, but he hadn't seen the simple approach that I had been teaching. And he went online and watched the lean burrito video. And when he introduced me, he said, you know, I could read through a whole litany of Paul's accomplishments, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to tell you what happened to me when I watched his lean burrito video. This is probably one of the best introductions I ever got, and you'll see why.
Hi, my name's Jeff Fuchs, and I just wanted to describe a little bit about what happened after I watched the lean burrito video. So I'm walking into my favorite